Extraordinary People. Proudly sponsored by Amazing Space Loft Conversions. Creating a better space for extraordinary living.
My guest is a veterinary surgeon, broadcaster, best-selling author, and animal welfare campaigner. He has become a household name through many media appearances, giving advice on animal health, as well as being a familiar face in Westminster through tireless campaigning and lobbying to improve animal welfare. As well as his work in the UK, his volunteering overseas has also seen him vaccinating dogs against rabies in the Mumbai slums, rescuing dancing bears in Ukraine, saving cats and dogs in post-tsunami Thailand, and performing dental work on a rescued moon bear in China. His recent breakthrough achievement was the culmination of a 10-year campaign against cruel puppy farming and resulted in a new government legislation called Lucy's Law. But instead of taking a well-deserved rest, he has already moved on to his next campaign to ban the legal importation of sick puppies from overseas puppy farms as well. He is Marc Abraham. Marc, welcome to Extraordinary People.
Thank you for inviting me.
Oh, I've read your book recently. I've completed reading it. And if you want to show it to the camera as well. Lucy's Law is such an extraordinary story on so many levels. I mean, your achievement, obviously, to start with. But your life, you know, your transformation on a personal basis as well, your family, the people you've met. We'll start by me asking you, just for the background of Lucy's Law, obviously, and if you tell me about the achievement itself. But later, I would like to move on and meet, not Marc the vet, because you're already very a familiar face, as we said, as Marc the vet, but Marc the person, the man behind the, you know, the whole story of Lucy's Law. So give me the background. What is Lucy's Law?
So Lucy's Law is a law named after a Cavalier King Charles Spaniel called Lucy, obviously, who was rescued from a legal licensed puppy farm, which are sort of places, big agricultural buildings, usually in rural areas, that mass produce puppies, usually for sale via third parties like pet shops to kind of unsuspecting pet owners. The problem is the welfare and the way that these breeding dogs are treated is so bad. The puppies are taken away too early. They're sold, transported and sold via third parties, and they're usually very sick, and they usually have medical, surgical, behavioural problems that make sure they either die quickly or they are seriously ill or require treatments their whole life and have a reduced life expectancy. So really, Lucy's Law was a ban on third-party sellers. So it's a ban on those middlemen, those dealers, the pet shops, that sell puppies without their mum.
Because it's so important to see a puppy with its mum.
Always when you're buying a puppy, you have to see it with its mum, interacting with its mum, preferably littermates as well, in the place it was born. And of course, that means that, you know, owners can see the mum and it's the whole process is transparent. But more importantly is that all the breeders are accountable. So if there's a problem with the puppy, they know exactly why and where that puppy was bought.
Right.
And that can then be investigated. The problem with the third party trade is because if there's a problem with the puppy, you don't always know where that puppy was born, whether it's in the UK or abroad.
Sure.
So it's always about accountability.
So all that sounds, you know, it makes perfect sense to me. However, it took you 10 years to get the government to change legislation about that.
And
it must have been, well, I know it was because I read the book, you know, a proper roller coaster.
It was, and it wasn't obviously just me. I was very privileged and honoured to lead the campaign, but it was a grassroots campaign. There was others involved, all doing it voluntarily. Geographically around the country, we were some of us in Wales, Cariad, and we had Philippa in Sheffield, Julia in Folkestone, we had Sarah in near Birmingham.
I mean, the thank you the acknowledgement section of that book is probably the longest I've ever seen, but that's understandable.
And that's because so many people were involved, not just for the grassroots campaigners, but the organisations that were involved, celebrities that were involved, the cross-party MPs that were involved. It was an incredible experience and, as you say, a roller coaster for 10 years.
Right.
But we finally got it over the line, and this year, in 2020, April the 6th, it became law. Lucy's Law became law, and it obviously still is, and it's working. It's fantastic to see. It's totally overwhelming, I have to admit.
I'm sure it is overwhelming. And you know, you yourself, you've mentioned all these people that you've worked with, a lot of celebrities that have, you know, agreed to work with you as well. And, you know, you've become a familiar face among politicians. But I want to go back to, to your childhood. And, you know...
the opposite of that.
A very, very different person. Yeah. You know, you yourself say in the book, and you repeated that you were actually quite a loner.
Loner, introvert, shy, wouldn't speak to people, had very few human friends, and just hung out with butterflies and caterpillars.
Right.
That was it.
Right.
I mean, I was happy. You know, my parents lived kind of suburbia, very safe upbringing, can't complain at all. But it was sort of bordering on fields in the countryside, just on the sort of greenbelt around northwest London. So I was just off in the woods and in the meadows and collecting stuff, and I'd draw. So I used to collect stuff and then bring it home and draw it and label it. Obviously always take it back. But we're talking about sort of broken eggshells and feathers and you know, frog spawn. And that was heaven for me. And it still is, weirdly.
Right,
when I'm
right.
in the countryside now, go for country walks, you know, in the South Downs, Cookhamere, I'm still identifying butterflies and caterpillars and birds by obviously seeing them, but also by their song. And I bore everyone that I share those walks with because I can't help it. It's the geek in me and the nerd that has to know all this information and then share it as much as possible. So, yeah,
and
I love it.
And really, I mean, so it's as if things were kind of, you know, you knew at a very young age that was
it's all
what
I ever
you wanted
to do.
Didn't you treat Speedy the tortoise at the age of three or something?
Yeah, I was three, and Speedy the tortoise had a wound on its leg and it had a maggot in the wound. And I got the maggot out with a twig in the back garden, and the leg got better and the tortoise got better and Speedy was happy. And I think that gave me my first sort of experience of how good it made me feel to help animals. And that was it.
Right.
That was all it was. And that was the trigger. And from then on, I only wanted to help animals, which obviously later on became being a vet. And I studied and studied and studied and couldn't do enough homework. I mean, it was a dream for my parents because I'd do my homework and then I'd invent more homework to do, and then I'd invent even more homework to do, and I just couldn't stop studying. I'd get up in the middle of the night and watch Open University documentaries about how ammonia was made. I couldn't learn enough. So when it came to exams, I did very well, but it was all because I had to get into vet school. That was the only thing I had
you
to
knew
do.
You knew that?
Yeah, and I did, obviously, and became a vet. But I never, ever saw this life of campaigning ever materialising.
Sure, things kind of developed in unexpected ways. But so going back to your background, obviously you had this innate love for nature and animals, etc. But your family was very important and still is, and has been a real, you know, different members of your family, role models for you. So your mother worked herself in a hospital and was an animal, still is an animal lover.
Huge animal lover and also a huge people helper.
Right.
Loads of empathy, massive community spirit. She's an incredible person and she can't stop helping people.
Right. And your father, I have to say, the book is, bits of the book made me very emotional, but I completely was in floods when I read the very last paragraph of the book, when you thank
those
your
spoilers.
Father.
Yeah.
And I won't. But so it was interesting that it's as if you made yourself a kind of psychological analysis in that, you know, you've connected the fact that you played chess with your father and tennis with your father to the fact that, in a way, you've learned how to think strategically about completely different things. Teamwork, perhaps thinking outside the box.
Well, considering I didn't really mix much with humans when I was growing up, I guess he was my best mate and was, obviously, until he passed away. But he taught me so much, you know, as you say, from chess, strategy, from playing tennis together, teamwork, from always going out into the woods. You know, he used to draw nature maps for me. I presume he wanted me to come home. It wasn't just for me to get lost in the woods.
Disappear.
But he taught me a lot. And the fascinating thing, which I've only really just realised in the last couple of years, is his job was in advertising. And advertising is, of course, campaigning. And campaigning is trying to get a simple message to as many people as possible and getting them to react positively. In the case of advertising, usually purchasing a product. And my career as a campaigner is exactly the same,
yes,
apart from the money bit. So it's
even down to, you know, the title Lucy's Law, you know, make it a personalised...
An alliteration, personalising it. That was all sent from him, I'm pretty sure, down from above. And, yeah, as you say, it's getting the simple message out, getting as many people to react as possible, and in this case, signing petitions or raising awareness or sharing a tweet. So sometimes when I'm in meetings in government, it's just like, this is happening to me that happened to him. I've got people running things past me about campaigning and what my thoughts are, when I'm pretty sure when he was in advertising, that would have been happening as well to him.
Right. And you did go to work with him sometimes.
Yeah,
you must have absorbed that kind of milieu.
I think so. But he was very unique at work because he didn't conform. And he would go to work in advertising in the 80s, which was very Armani suits and cool glasses and smoking and drinking and God knows what else. And he didn't do any of that. And instead of the suit, he would wear jeans, T-shirt and trainers.
Right.
And he always kind of taught me to value people for what they kind of bring to the table and who they are.
OK, Marc, we have to stop here.
Rather than what they look like.
But we'll come back to talking about your very interesting family after the break.
Thank you.
Welcome back. With me is Marc Abraham, the extraordinary vet and person. Marc, we were talking about your parents just before your break, and mm-hmm. just before the break, and it's obvious that you know you've been very attached to your parents. But I also want to talk about the very extraordinary woman that is your grandmother,
yeah,
who is 99 and a half.
Yeah, next month.
And her story, which is seemingly unrelated to your story, actually has some parallels that you yourself identified in the book. So maybe just briefly, because we don't have so much time,
sure,
but tell me the incredible story of how your grandmother came to England.
Well, she is Jewish, and she grew up in a town called Meissen, which is in East Germany, or then East Germany, which is near Dresden. And she was subject to a lot of anti-Semitism when Hitler was rising in the late 30s. Treated badly at school, they were told to spit on her, she wore the yellow star, she was made to sit alone, etc. And then one day she came home from school and her parents had gone and they'd been taken to Auschwitz to be gassed. And she was slightly too old to make what was called the kinder transport. She was a year above that sort of maximum age.
The kinder transport, for those who don't know, was a rescue operation in which Jewish kids...
Masterminded by the UK government,
yes,
in which 10,000 Jewish kids were taken from Germany and brought to the UK to safety. So, and I think the cut-off age was, I think, maybe 15 or 16. She was just slightly over that. Anyway, she escaped and she got to the train station and she was too old. And then she had this incredible idea, which was to run to a fancy dress shop, get a nurse's uniform, come back and prepare, pretend to be a red nurse, a Red Cross nurse, saving the kids. So she got on the train and she escaped that way. And I think she threw her parents' jewellery out the window and she was then coming to the UK and she was the only one of 10,000 kids that arrived who actually didn't have someone waiting for her, which is quite interesting. So she was now a 16, 17-year-old German young adult in England who was at war with Germany with nowhere to go. So she kind of made a whole life for herself. She's lived in the UK. She's spent some time in New York. She's back here now, and she's unbelievable. So she's a real testament to the fact that anything is possible. And when you're faced with whatever adversity, murdered parents, escaping, coming to a country that's at war with where you've just come from, so you're kind of you're being hated in one place and pretty much being hated in another, that anything is possible. And I think that was always an inspiring thought for me campaigning. Every time I hit a brick wall, which readers of Lucy's Law book will be familiar with all the brick walls that we did face and the obstructions and the disingenuous behaviour by certain organisations and individuals, it was always that thought of her overcoming anything that I thought we can get through this.
And then she actually sat with you at Westminster,
yeah,
when the legislation was debated, and that, yeah, was very important for
it
you.
It was important,
well,
and emotional, because she only existed because of the House of Commons and I only existed because of her. and the campaign only existed because of me. So it was this weird loop of everything helping everything else out. But right. It was so random because she's this immigrant German kid who came over escaping from the Nazis. You got the UK House of Commons, the main chamber where the actual decision for the kinder transport was made and approved. And then we got my campaign being debated. And it was incredibly, incredibly emotional at that point.
I can imagine.
Because it hit us all at the same time. It was very strange.
Right. Well, they must be very proud of you.
I hope so.
The family.
By now.
Let's talk a bit about the campaign, because you really did start not knowing anything about campaigning. And, you know, a lot of campaigns, a lot of lobbying has actually been done by PR companies, you know, people who paid a lot of money to do it. Yes, and you started not knowing anything.
Nothing.
And, you know, reading the book, I mean, it was a combination of obviously very hard work, having quite a lot of chutzpah, for want of a better word, but also a lot of luck. And there are two examples that I would love you to quickly go through. One involving celebrities, really. One is with Bob Geldof and the other one with a guitar.
Yeah.
Do you want to quickly go through
Well, when you're a grassroots campaigner, you really have no resources in terms of money or that sort of capital that you can sort of get an advert on the telly or... You know what I mean? It's you have nothing. So you have to be so creative. It's where my dad comes in again as a creative director in advertising. And to be honest with you, it's always thinking outside the box and it's always thinking about things that make things newsworthy. And of course, puppy farming isn't very cool. So what do you do? So the first one you mentioned was, I think it was Bob Geldof. And that was when I was doing a live show on the Alan Titchmarsh show. And I knew he was coming on as a guest. And of course, Pup Aid, which was my awareness-raising dog show, which started in Brighton and ended up going to Primrose Hill. The first flyers for Pup Aid were at the top of a guitar that went into a dog chew, a bit like top of a guitar going into Africa for Live Aid. And I knew he was coming on the show, so I took with me the posters and the flyers, and I showed him, and he was so excited by this. And he was only on because it was the 20-year anniversary of Live Aid. And you know the funny Live Aid story in here as well, which I had tickets for backstage and I didn't go
because
I was getting my chemistry prize. Oh, mental. But anyway, he grabbed all the posters and the flyers, took it on the interview with him, and I was sitting in the green room because I'd already done my bit on microchipping or something, and watched Bob Geldof showing Pup Aid flyers to the camera saying that he'd inspired Pup Aid from Live Aid, which he had. So that was funny.
And when Bob Geldof says that on live TV, obviously
It was so funny.
The publicity is incredible.
And it was just one of those, another sort of one of those moments where things sort of come together.
Yes.
And the guitar was similar in a way, but I was on holiday and I was talking to some people and I think the guy drove the guitar, Gibson guitars around in a van to deliver. Got talking and then, you know, would they consider, you know, donating a guitar? Yes, went to Rathbone Street to Gibson Guitar HQ. Yeah, only if I could find someone that could sign it. Of course, Meg Matthews by then was our patron, Meg Matthews, who was married to Noel Gallagher. So I asked Meg, and she said, oh, Uncle Liam will sign it. So we met Uncle Liam Gallagher, and at the time Nicole Appleton, with their little Dachshund Ruby Tuesday at Gibson HQ. And he signed it, and we did the picture. And then it was signed by Brian May and David Gilmour and all these sort of rock legends. Who else was it? Eric Clapton, I think Keith Richards signed it, 10 people. And it went for auction and it made loads of a few thousand pounds for rescue dogs. So it just showed that from all these tiny little things, you can actually make things happen. And that are newsworthy.
But do you in some way enjoy that kind of... I mean, you've become a bit of a celebrity yourself.
Oh, I hate that word. Yeah, well-known figure in the animal welfare world, I'd choose... Anytime.
Right, but at the same time, I mean, you know, say in terms of politics, you're very honest in the book in that, you're critical of the government on many occasions, but at the same time, you kind of got in there. You've chosen the Prime Minister's.
I sourced the rescue dog Dylan for the Prime Minister and his fiancée Carrie.
Right.
It was another weird story, which is all in here, of course.
So you're sort of mixing in those circles of critical of the government on the one hand and then kind of mates with a lot of them on the other hand.
The difference is being critical and providing a solution.
Right.
Not just going, should have done that, you shouldn't do that, should blame. That's almost too easy. When you're a campaigner, you always have to provide a solution. And Lucy's Law was a solution. The ban the puppy imports, there's a solution, which is to, you know, raise the minimum age to 6 months for puppies coming in. So for me, I'm happy to scrutinise and criticise because I'm saying there's a better way of doing it,
right,
rather than what are you doing and all the rest of it,
right,
which a lot of people do. And I believe it's important to provide solutions because it's just too easy to criticise otherwise.
And apart from providing solutions and campaigning, I have the feeling that kind of educating people is very important for you.
Yeah.
I mean, you're doing whatever you can to educate the public about mm-hmm. how to deal with their pets, how to buy mm-hmm. animals, for example. You're educating the government. You have been to schools talking to children.
Yeah.
Is it a burning passion with you?
Yeah. I love raising awareness. I genuinely believe if you raise enough awareness causing a behaviour change, it's almost maybe sometimes even more effective than changing the law. But the two definitely go hand in hand. And if you can do both well, then you're going to be a lot more successful as a campaigner.
Right.
So, and also, I think there's a hunger for people to learn information, especially about animals. If you're an animal lover, you can't know enough about dogs or cats or whatever your chosen species. But I love educating, I love sharing information. And that now is on another level, which is sharing campaigning tips and information with other campaigners.
Yes, so you're becoming a sort of generic campaigning. You actually are a campaigner now and you can provide some support
to
people about it.
And there's so many different campaigns going on at the moment. There's pet theft reform, greyhound racing. There's a lot of things going on that with my experience of campaigning, and I've got to say, it's not just about Lucy's Law and animal welfare. There's a lot of tips in here about how to campaign.
Right.
You know.
And Mark, we have time for just one more quick thing.
Sure.
You quote the Dalai Lama in your book. You say, if you think you are, or he said, if you think you're too small to change things.
If you think you're too small to change the world, try sleeping with a mosquito. And it's really important for people to be more mosquito and to challenge things, but also to challenge and provide solutions. And instead of blaming stuff or blaming people, start an e-petition against it.
Just do it.
You know, meet up with other campaigners. You'll find them online. But do something proactive and constructive rather than moaning, finger-pointing and blaming others.
Marc Abraham, thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thanks for inviting me.